Hello, my name is Erkan Tairi, and I will present post-quantum adaptor signature for privacy-preserving off-chain payments. This is a joint work with Pedro Moreno-Sanchez and Matteo Maffei. Before starting with adaptor signatures, let's look into conditional payments. Conditional payments form the backbone of a rich set of off-chain functionalities, such as payment channel networks, payment channel hubs, and many others. We can construct conditional payments using hash time lock contracts, which makes use of a cryptographic hash function. We can consider two parties, namely Alice and Bob, such that Alice wants to pay to Bob condition on some cryptographic puzzle. In this case, Alice pays Bob 1 Bitcoin if and only if Bob can come up with a pre-image X of the hash value Y before certain time T. Although HTLCs are useful for constructing conditional payments, they have certain disadvantages. For example, they require all cryptocurrencies to support the same hash function. Using the same hash value across multiple payments can hinder privacy, they add undesirable on-chain footprint, and they lack fungibility altogether. So what's an adaptor signature is that it is an ordinary digital signature scheme extended with a hard relation. It was first introduced by Poelstra and very recently formalized by Aumeier et al. Adaptor signatures can also be used to construct conditional payments. In this case, the conditional payment is conditioned on the hard relation R. More precisely, in this case, Alice pays Bob 1 Bitcoin if and only if Bob can come up with the witness small y before time t. The advantage of using an adaptor signature-based conditional payment, as opposed to the hash time lock contract one previously shown, is that we do not need an additional cryptographic primitive, such as a hash function, and we can leverage the digital signature scheme that is already supported by the cryptocurrency. Furthermore, adaptor signatures provide low on-chain cost and improve the fungibility of transactions. As previously mentioned, an adaptor signature combines a digital signature scheme with a hard relation R. We say that a relation is hard if given only the statement, it is hard to find the corresponding witness in polynomial time. An adaptor signature is composed of four algorithms, namely pre-signature, pre-verification, adaptation, and extraction. Although adaptor signatures are defined as a regular cryptographic primitive, their main use case usually involve a two-party protocol. Continuing from our previous example, where Alice wants to pay Bob condition on the statement capital Y, what Alice can do is that she can compute a pre-signature that is conditioned on this statement Y. Then Alice sends this pre-signature to Bob, who first verifies that the pre-signature is correct. If the verification passes, then Bob can just complete the pre-signature using his witness small y in order to obtain a full signature, which he shares with Alice in order to get paid by her. Now Alice, using the pre-signature sigma hat and the full signature sigma, can use the extraction algorithm in order to extract the witness that Bob used. So essentially, a pre-signature acts as a commitment that guarantees that given a valid witness, one can turn it into a complete valid signature. Moreover, given any valid pair of full signature and a pre-signature, one can extract the witness. Like any other cryptographic primitive, an adaptor signature scheme also needs to have certain correctness and security properties. More precisely, an adaptor signature needs to provide unforgeability, pre-signature adaptability, and witness extraction. The unforgeability notion is similar to the unforgeability in regular digital signature schemes, which essentially says that it is infeasible for an adversary to forge signature. However, here an adversary is allowed to additionally query pre-signatures of its choosing. Pre-signature adaptability means that anyone with a valid witness to the statement Y can complete a pre-signature that is computed under the same statement Y. Lastly, witness extractability means that any valid pre-signature-signature pair computed under the statement Y is enough to extract the corresponding witness of the statement Y. After the motivation and introduction of adaptor signatures, we can come to the question as to why do we need post-quantum adaptor signatures. Well, one reason is that the existing adaptor signatures that were constructed by Aumeier et al. Are broken by a quantum computer due to Shor's algorithm, which is a quantum polynomial time algorithm. Furthermore, there is an ongoing standardization process by NIST for standardizing encryption and digital signature schemes that are post-quantum secure. And if blockchains are there to stay in the long run, they need to provide post-quantum security as well. However, we are not the first ones to consider this question. Very recently, Ezgin et al. Constructed a lattice-based adaptor signature scheme called LIS that is based on module sys and module LWU problems, though their construction has several drawbacks, as we will see now. The first drawback of LIS comes due to the inherent knowledge gap of lattice-based zero-knowledge proofs. More precisely, they need to consider two relations, a base relation R and an extended relation R', where extended means that it includes witnesses with bigger norm compared to the base relation R. For this reason, LIS only achieves what's called a weak pre-signature adaptability. The weak part comes from the fact that the pre-signature adaptability only works for witnesses that belong to the base relation R, whereas witness extraction only guarantees that the extracted witnesses belong to the extended relation R'. This essentially means that the extracted witnesses do not guarantee adaptability. More precisely, the construction only has imperfect correctness. This means that in order to provide correctness in practice, all applications that make use of LIS need to also use an expensive exact lattice-based zero-knowledge proof, which proves that the witness actually has a small norm and belongs to the base relation R. Another drawback of LIS is that some off-chain applications, such as the payment channel network construction of Malavolta et al., require several concatenated instances of pre-signatures with interleaved conditions. What I mean here by interleaved conditions is that each condition or statement y+i+1 is computed as a function of the previous condition y+i and random value z. And the privacy of such constructions require that each intermediate statement witness pair is indistinguishable from others. For example, in a group-based setting such as using a Schnorr or ECDSA as a digital signature with discrete logarithm as the underlying hard relation, we have that each z value is sampled randomly from zq, and each intermediate condition y+i+1 is computed as y+i times g to the z. Now, due to the underlying modular arithmetic, we have that each witness is indistinguishable from the other. Whereas in the lattice setting, using LIS and module sys as the hard relation, we have that each z value is a random vector sampled from a distribution of vectors of norm 1, and each condition y+i+1 is computed as y+i+a×z for a public matrix A. However, when we add two vectors of norm 1, with high probability we will end up with a vector of norm 2. So essentially, this means that if we use a lattice-based adaptor signature, we have that each intermediate witness has a norm that is bigger than the one before with high probability, and this in turn hinders the privacy of such applications. As we saw, the lattice-based adaptor signature has an imperfect correctness and hinders the privacy of some off-chain applications that use it. This naturally brings us to the following question. Can we construct an adaptor signature scheme that is correct and secure against quantum adversaries, but preserves the privacy guarantees of the off-chain applications built on top of it? And the answer is yes, we constructed such an adaptor signature from isogeny-based cryptography. But before describing the actual construction, I would like to give some brief mathematical preliminaries. So what we consider in this work are group actions. A group action on a group G of set X is a function that takes elements from G and X and maps them to X. This furthermore satisfies certain properties. More precisely, for an identity element E of G, we have that E action X is equal to X itself, and G times H action X is the same as computing G action H action X. Furthermore, we say that the group is one way if given a pair of XY, where Y is G action X for a random G, it is infeasible for an attacker to find G. As an example, we can consider the group of a prime order Q with generator H. Then the group action is the natural exponentiation. However, in this case, both Z sub Q and H itself are groups. But we note that this does not have to be the case generally in group actions. Moreover, if discrete logarithm is hard over H, then this group action is one way. And as mentioned, in this case, H is not only a set, but it is a group. And due to this algebraic structure, the one-wayness property does not hold against quantum attackers. Similarly, we can construct an isogeny-based group action. More precisely, if we let G be the quasi group of an order in an imaginary quadratic field, and let X be the set of elliptic curves with complex multiplication by the same order, then we have an isogeny based group action. Such a group action is already used in seaside and seafish constructions. If we compare this with the previously seen DDH-based group action, the difference is that in DDH setting we can multiply two elements from H, since it is a group. However, in isogeny-based setting we do not have any meaningful operation between two elements from X. More precisely, we cannot combine two elliptic curves. For a detailed exposition of cryptographic group actions, refer to the work of Alamati et al. So before presenting our isogeny-based adaptor signature construction, I want to point out to the notation that we will use in the rest of this talk. This is only for the sake of simplifying the exposition. So instead of using star notation for the group action, we use a bracket notation. Since quasi group is a finite group with a generator G, we write the group action G to the A action E simply as bracket A times E. Under this notation, we get that bracket E bracket B is equal to bracket A plus B. The last thing that I want to mention before presenting our construction is that the security of our adaptor signature scheme along with the underlying hard relation that we use is based on the group action inversion problem. It essentially says that given two elliptic curves, E and E prime, along with an isogeny based group action that we just saw, it is hard for an adversary to invert this group action. The best-known classical algorithm for this problem requires exponential time, and the best-known quantum algorithm requires sub-exponential time, and is this Cooperberg's algorithm for the hidden shift problem. The starting point of our construction is an isogeny-based identification scheme, which is essentially the Schnorr's identification scheme cast to isogeny setting. So an interactive identification scheme allows a party, in this case Bob, to prove his identity to another party, in this case Alice. Proving the identity here corresponds to proving knowledge of the secret key for the corresponding public key of the prover. In this case, public key is E sub PK and the secret key is S. So how Bob can prove his identity here is that he can sample a random R and compute the action of R with the designated base curve E sub 0, which yields the curve E sub R here. Then the verifier Alice can set a random challenge bit B, to which Bob replies by returning R if the bit was 0, and returning R times S inverse if the bit was 1. Then Alice can simply compute the corresponding group action and check whether the end result is E sub R. Applying Fiat-Shamir transform to such an interactive identification scheme to make it non-interactive yields a digital signature scheme. The previously shown identification scheme has soundness of 1 over 2, because the challenge space is a single bit. We can increase the soundness by using multiple public keys, for example by using S public keys, so in this case meaning S elliptic curves, and also using their quadratic twists, we can increase the soundness to 1 over 2S minus 1. Now in order to achieve lambda bits of security, we have to repeat the identification protocol T times, where T is set to lambda over log S. Combining these approaches with the Fiat-Shamir transform to turn the interactive identification scheme into a digital signature scheme, we obtain the isogeny-based digital signature scheme CFISH. Starting from CFISH digital signature scheme, we can construct an isogeny-based adaptor signature by using GAIP as the underlying hard relation. For simplicity, I present here the base scheme with the binary challenge space. One can boost the soundness using the techniques explained earlier. The main technical challenge in constructing an isogeny-based adaptor signature scheme comes in pre-signature algorithm. Let's first contrast Schnorr-based digital signature scheme with an isogeny-based one. We can observe that they are very similar with a few minor differences. First, in the Schnorr case, the randomness is sampled from ZQ and computed as exponentiation, whereas in isogeny-based scheme, the randomness is sampled from the quasi group and computed as a group action. Next, we see that the signatures are computed identically, with the only exception that in Schnorr we work modulo Q, since we sample from ZQ, whereas in isogeny-based scheme we work modulo N, where N is the size of the quasi group. So how we can turn a regular Schnorr signature into an adaptor signature is by augmenting the randomness with the statement Y. So essentially, what we compute here is a partial signature, since the witness of statement Y is missing from the signature S hat. and this works in Schnorr since we work over a group. However, if we try to apply the same technique in isogeny-based construction by setting the randomness to be not only E sub R, but E sub R times the statement E sub Y, then we run into problems. And the problem is what we saw earlier with the isogeny-based group action. In isogeny-based group action, there is no meaningful operation between two elliptic curves. So we have no way here to combine two elliptic curves in order to end up with a third one as in the group-based setting. So how we can solve the previous problem is by randomizing the statement E sub Y with the group action of the randomness E sub R and proving zero knowledge the relation between E sub R and E sub Y. This corresponds to a DH tuple proof for isogenies. Now, this all sounds a bit too abstract, so let's see what exactly needs to change from our previous non-working construction. So essentially, what needs to change here are the blue parts. If we look more closely what we compute, so essentially what it means to randomize the statement with the group action of the randomness E sub R, is to compute another randomness E sub R hat, which is the computation of R action E sub Y. Now, using our notation, this means that we end up with R plus Y E sub 0. Then we can use E sub R hat as the actual randomness of the signature and end up with a partial signature since S hat only has the R value and the witness of the statement E sub Y is missing. Lastly, we extend the pre-signature with the randomness E sub R hat and the zero knowledge proof in order to help in the verification. So how we can verify this pre-signature scheme is similar to the verification in the identification scheme. By multiplying the S hat value with the public key to obtain the original randomness E sub R. Now once we obtain that, we can verify the attached zero knowledge proof, and if the verification does not pass, we abort, and otherwise we compute E prime and check whether it matches the E value that comes from the pre-signature, which is analogous to the Schnorr-based construction. What remains to consider are the adaptation and extraction algorithms. However, these algorithms will be analogous to Schnorr-based constructions, adaptation and extraction algorithms, with the only difference is that now we work modulo n instead of modulo q. So in adapt algorithm, the party that knows the witness y can add it to the partial signature s hat to obtain a full valid signature s. Additionally, here we drop the randomness e sub r hat and the zero knowledge proof pi from the final signature since they are no longer needed. In the extraction, we simply subtract the complete signature S from the partial signature S hat to obtain the witness Y prime. Previously, we saw the drawbacks of the lattice-based adaptor signature scheme of Esgin et al., and the drawbacks were twofold. First, the extracted witnesses do not guarantee adaptability, so it has imperfect correctness. And second, when it is used as a building block for certain off-chain applications that require several concatenated instances of pre-signatures with interleaved conditions, it hinders the privacy of the applications. The main culprit in both of these drawbacks is the noisy nature of lattice-based schemes, which essentially causes a knowledge gap and increases the norm of the vectors in applications. Our isogeny-based adaptor signature construction overcomes these issues due to the underlying group action structure. So essentially, we achieve perfect correctness and we do not harm the privacy of the off-chain applications that use our construction. We also evaluated the performance of our isogeny-based adaptor signature scheme using a parallelized C implementation. The reason for the parallelized implementation is that in order to provide adequate levels of security, the basic identification scheme needs to be repeated multiple times, and all these repetitions are independent of each other and they are prone to parallelization. Now, there are two things that I want to draw your attention to. The first is that the S, number of public keys, and T, the number of iterations that one needs to do of the identification scheme, are inversely related. As the number of public keys increases, the number of iterations decreases. However, naturally, as the number of public keys increases, the running time of the key generation increases. But of course, the signing time reduces since we need to perform less iterations. The second point is that the main bottleneck of our construction is the expensive zero-knowledge proof used in pre-signatures. And this is visible from our signing and pre-signing computation times, along with the size of pre-signature sigma hat and the complete signature sigma. With that, I want to conclude. We constructed isogeny-based adaptor signature scheme based on CFISH and proven secure in quantum random oracle model. Unlike lattice-based adaptor signature, due to the group action structure, our isogeny-based construction achieves perfect correctness and do not hinder the privacy of off-chain applications that use it. Furthermore, our technique to construct isogeny-based adaptor signature is generic enough to be applicable to other isogeny-based signature schemes, such as the recently introduced SkiSign digital signature scheme. And lastly, the future work is to improve the performance and obtain better security estimates for our construction. Thank you for your attention.